What up, meatheads? This is Travis, American Butcher, and this is the Meat Block Podcast, the weekly podcast by butchers for everyone. And man, it feels good to be in the studio, maybe for the last time, maybe the second to last time where I produce something in this humble abode that I, or my house in my garage overlooking the woods in the Pacific Northwest. And there is a squatch looking at me, North American bipedal primate, just painting the picture. I always wanted to be a cryptozoologist, but once the animals discover, you are no longer an expert in something that is undiscovered. That's just food for thought. What does that have to do with this podcast? If you're listening to it or joining us for the first time, this is Meat Block, or the Meat Block, where we talk about meat. We talk about the industry, food, we give recipes, we do interviews, we do a multitude of things. And you may be wondering what we're going to do in this episode. Well, we're going to be talking about chicks, man. Nah, not Joe McHale, not the talk soup early days. I'm sure someone out there is getting my deep cuts, my deep dives into pop culture from the early 2000s, late 90s. Anyway, we're going to be talking about chicken processing, slaughter, the steps, and Ryan got a great interview. So sit back, enjoy, and meat block.
Good cutting enhances the quality of good meat. In his way, the meat cutter is an artist. Poor cutting results in an inferior piece of meat, regardless of quality.
Someone asked me once how many animals they thought that I processed or that I killed or slaughtered or dispatched or harvested or whatever word you want to use that sounds better than slitting it in the throat or shooting it in the head. And I thought about it, you know, it was like so many beef a day, you know, 15 beef in a day, you know, on pig days we do like, you know, 60, on lamb days we do like 120, sometimes like 140. And, you know, all right, so I was at that position for this long, and I did this. And then I forgot that every Fridays at my first job in this industry, we would slaughter chickens, and I would work the stunning knife. It's an electric knife that you hold up. I haven't done it in a while, so I have to visually shut my eye. And right behind the eye, and it electrocutes them, and you're holding a super thick glove, and you're standing on a mat so you don't get shocked. And then this electric knife also is a knife, so the electric makes them unconscious, and then you slit their throat, leaving the trach intact. So you just cut the two jugulars on either side, and they're upside down on a shackle. And yeah, so I had that job, and I started thinking like, well, we're doing like 1,300 a day, and I killed for a solid 2 years every Friday. And then my numbers started shooting up. You know, this isn't like something to brag about, but this is just like the honest truth to get this answer of that someone asked me, well, how many animals do you think you've killed? I think the rough estimate that I came up with was over 70,000, most of them chickens. But yet I rarely talk about chicken or, butchering chickens. I talk, you know, I've touched bases on slaughtering chickens, but we're going to go a little bit more in depth in perhaps my background and in chicken processing. So I was working in the industry for about 4 days. Or 3 days before it was a chicken day. And I was working exclusively kill. It was my introduction to the industry, working on a kill line. My first day, you know, first seconds on the kill floor, I killed an animal. I also cut myself like the first time I had a knife in my hand. And I was like, wow, this is going to be a long career. But back then, I wasn't even a meat cutter. I was barely a slaughterman. I was so green. So it wasn't like this is going to be a long career, because I didn't even think of it as a career. I thought of it as a job, of just something to do to pay the rent. something I could, you know, and you've heard me say it before that my brother offered me the job and said that within so many years or in this time frame, within 3 years, I'll make you into a butcher and all this stuff. And that really didn't mean anything to me at the time. And now it means the world to me. And I want to say thank you for that. But back then, my living situation was changing and I didn't have a place to stay. And moving out of Santa Barbara and moving into, you know, rural Vermont and stepping into a slaughter facility, it happened very quickly. And but anyway, chickens. So Fridays was chickens. I woke up that morning. I remember it vividly because I was sick and from traveling and stress and who knows, I killed, you know, a bunch of cows for the first time and it was my third day in Vermont. So I had terrible diarrhea, like nervous diarrhea, like traveler sickness. And I woke up at 5 because we had to be at the plant at like 6:30 or something like that. I told my brother, I was like, I don't know if I could make it in because like I just had the mud butts and I was all fucked up from the time change. And he told me he would have understood if I didn't come in because, or didn't go into work with him because, you know, how I was feeling. So I opted to stay home or stay at his house because I didn't really have a home. And a few hours later, or about an hour later, I felt better. Ended up getting a ride to the processing plant or the slaughter facility, walking out and going onto the kill floor and there not being a crew there, then asking, you know, like, where is everyone? And no one really knew who I was because I was only there for like 3 days. So they just like, more or less like, who are you? And then pointing me down into the basement where the poultry processing happened every Friday. And it was wild. It was like a party. There's music. You know, there was more crew than on a normal day because this chicken line, it was an old gravity line that was given to us by a chicken producing company that in exchange, we harvested their birds for scientific reasons that they would, you know, bring us roughly about like 1,500 birds once every 2 months. And then they would say, all right, this bird hatched at this time and it's this many weeks old and it weighs this much. All right, this bird hatched at this time, it weighs this much, you know. And each bird had a band that was around their leg and we would kill them and all 1,500 birds would go into landfill because they're just using them to work on their feed formula. They would bring all 1,500 birds and they had to leave with all 1,500 birds. And I remember some of the employees being like, well, can I get one if you guys are just going to throw them out? And they're like, no, like, because they were like science birds, show birds, as we would call them. This episode is not an episode in sustainability. All those birds went into landfill once they were weighed and documented for their research purposes. Later, I heard that company was donating them to a canned soup company after weighing them and doing all that, but I wouldn't be surprised if they didn't. And that's just a side story how we got this gravity feed line that we're using. We didn't exclusively process their birds. In exchange for the line, they got free processing and we got to use it to make money, you know, charging so many a head per chickens. And I'll tell you, like, chicken processing is where the money's at if you are the only one in town for small farms. I mean, so to run a poultry line, you need more people than you would a traditional kill floor because there's more stations. So these people that would come every Friday to work chickens with us were people who didn't have other work or who were also available. And in the area of the country I was living at the time, it was very poor. There was a big opioid crisis happening. So the workforce was very colorful. It was a party. You know, we had today's best variety blasting in the background. Everyone would sing. Everyone would, you know, one person would leave a cigarette out inspection pins and like 20 people would take a drag off it and running just, you know, like, oh, this is breaking the line. I'm going to go do this. You know, when the line would get stopped for various reasons, everyone would run outside and chain smoke wearing all their aprons. But let's walk down the line, essentially. So the birds are received. And the person receiving writes down the farmer's name, how many birds they have, and what they want. They want their necks and their gizzards and their liver and heart. The USDA will look at these birds while they're alive, make sure that there's enough room, that they're not cramped, and that you know, they're healthy. There may be a dead bird in one out of every 20 cages. And, you know, the inspector will want you to get that bird out of there sooner rather than later. And then that person who's receiving these live birds, you know, they're received in it was an open garage that was covered from the elements. So like rain and things like that. Sometimes we would get, when it was unusually hot out, because poultry season is seasonal, it's actual seasonal work. So when it starts in the spring, you know, birds are healthy, things like that. Long drives in the hottest summer, you start getting more dead birds showing up in your antemortem inspection. And in the wintertime, they don't freeze because their body heat will keep them warm, but the climate change or something, you end up with more dead birds. Sometimes you end up with receiving chicken crates with snow on top of them. So the person receiving takes note, gives the driver a slip. The driver will then leave and then be like, all right, so we got 10 cages, 10 birds per cage, 100 birds for driver F. And then you do that until you end up with about 1,000 to 1,500 birds, with varying from like 20 to 30 farmers. Now, one farmer could bring you 400 birds. You just know at your limit, all right, I can only process this many on this day. And for small farms, it's usually one day worth of processing, unless they want to have fresh chicken at their farmer's market, never frozen. That it doesn't really make sense to bring 10 birds, you know, with $5 a head processing, because your price goes down per number of birds you bring. So that plant employee who inspects the birds is also the person who we had hanging the birds and lining them up and be like, all right, so this crate of birds is next. That's all these birds is one farmer. So the person killing, who was me, would yell down the line, all right, this bird's coming down. And say your biggest group of birds may be like 500 birds, and your biggest group is going to be no bands. You're going to write that on your receiving sheet, no bands. And you have a, like the next group of birds, say it's like 500 or 200. And then to tell them apart from the other no band birds, you're going to ban the left leg. You're going to write on your receiving sheet, banned left leg. And that means you take a white rubber band, wrap it around its leg after the scalding process and plucking process to identify it in the ice bucket, because we're going to be slush chilling these birds, and they're going to be mixing in with dozens of other farms. And people always complain, this isn't my meat. And this is the system that we came up with to ensure that it is your meat. So you have 15 different farmers, you're going to have 15 different band systems. Maybe it's a red rubber band, a blue rubber band, a green rubber band, a double rubber band, a rubber band on each leg, one on the wing, or something like that. We're going to come up with a system and a way to document it to help us during the process. So the person hanging the birds, he will grab the birds, may grab them one at a time, two at a time, three at a time, four at a time, five at a time, but no more than five at a time, because the USDA frowns upon that. I used to think that was absurd until I had the bird hanging position one day, or was killing and hanging my own birds. And I realized I could hold well over 5 birds at a time. Never thought I would need to, but I certainly could. 3 in each hand, 1 between your legs, you got 7 birds. So the conveyor belt is an oval. And I'm standing at one end of the oval, and it makes a circle, you know. And so the person shackles, I stun, the knife goes on for 8 seconds, then I cut, goes through a bleed tunnel to collect the blood. At the end of this oval, it goes, drops automatically into the scalder. There's a person there monitoring the scalder temperature and putting the birds physically in it. And the shackle is empty and goes on the backside of the oval and returns to the shackling person, ready for a new bird. From the scalder, it would go into a rotating plucker. You'd fit about 7 to 10 birds in there at a time and spin around for so many revolutions or seconds. I think it was like 30 seconds. I don't know. It's been a long time since I've had to know. And then the birds would come out with no feathers on. So these birds right now are considered closed. Once you open them, they need to be on a rack. But considering that they're closed, you could do table work. And it goes to a cropping table. And one person ran the cropping table or the crop station. The birds would be facing the person. They would cut along the neck of the bird when the bird was facing up and then hook their finger in and then separate the crop from the neck. And this is why people want you to not feed your bird within 24 hours of slaughter. Because if that crop is full, it bursts and it's full of seed and it's gross and it gets everywhere. It's a contaminant. It's not good. So if you're a farmer listening to this, don't feed your birds 24 hours before you process them or send them off to processing. It makes everyone's job harder. Also, send your birds in clean pens or clean crates because they will eat the shit and their crop may be full of other poop that they've eaten just on their way in transport. Then the birds would be slid over on this table that had a built-in drain, like a sausage table, and then be hung and shackled on a different oval line. Because these birds are about to be opened up, and this table bridged the gap between two rooms. So essentially you had a dirty kill room, and then you would crop it and slide it through to a new room through this table that was connected through a window. And now this is the clean room. 2 people would shackle the birds. 1 person would run a bung gun that literally goes, or a vent gun. And a vent gun, there's suction on it, and it's like a hole saw, like if you've ever drilled a big hole, where there's suction, and it sucks the anus of the bird into this circle, and then you pull the trigger, and then it spins it around, so it bungs it, but leaves it intact. And you got to hit it at the right angle because you don't want to burst the anal cavity and end up with shit all inside people's food. Now, I used to vent birds by hand, and I got super good at it and watched because when I was done killing, or when I, you know, I didn't kill every day, I made it a goal to learn every position eventually. And I used to draw birds, which is the next step. So after they're bunged, you take a vent knife, which is just a small poultry knife, and then you make a small cut towards the breast, big enough to get your 4 fingers in at a scoop, and you draw the bird and have the viscera hanging off to the side, still on the shackles for inspection. Now, the best people at this job have petite, slender hands. So after they would be drawn, the inspector would look at the viscera, make sure that there's no jelly belly, there's no septicemia, there's no other words, abscess, or broken appendages, legs, wings, etc. And if there was, the next position on the other side of her was the trimmer. And our trimmer was this awesome, stoic, super quiet, awkward guy. And our inspector had a awesome, sweet Southern accent. And she'd be like, excuse me, could you trim off this wang? She would also say phrases like, well, if I can't use that word, Travis, how could I tell them apart? So the trimmer would pull down the rest of the viscera, and the crop is loose, so it falls down. And then he would trim wings or legs, or she would say, like, this bird is condemned, and it would go in a bucket that would be denatured later in the day. From here, it went to the lung scrapers and the kidney scrapers. And there's a tool that you could use for it, the lung gun, and you stick it in there and go, and it sucks it all out. And you could also use the lung scraper, which is a little hand tool. I always found it best to just use my fingers. I couldn't imagine doing it now because my hands just go numb randomly. Back then, my hands weren't as shit as they are now. And they'd just go into this giant steel vacuum tank where they would be emptied out. And I remember emptying it out once when I was there, and or going down to the poultry room being like, what's that smell? And it was because it wasn't emptied out at the end of season, and we were getting ready for the next season, and then we discovered it, and it was gross, and it was awful. Then from here, you have another trimmer. And this trimmer isn't trimming for broken legs or broken wings. They're harvesting trimming. So they have a bucket with a lugger or a tote with an ice bath solution already in it. And they're cutting feet, cutting necks off, and, harvest, making sure that the livers get harvested and these things. And then that is going to be labeled so they can be packaged with the birds if the farmer wants these things. After the harvesting trimmer, they would go to a wash station, which was two people with hoses with spray nozzles, and they just rinse the crap out of the birds, making sure there's no pinned feathers left on the wings. You know, we didn't do any candling, so we didn't burn any feathers off. We did it all by hand, making sure there's no pieces of trachea, making sure there's no lungs left, making sure there's no kidneys. Then they would also be responsible for ensuring that the rubber bands were on them and putting them in the ice bath. We had two floaters around, and their job was to make sure the ice was ready, that the help with unloading, to do general cleaning as we went along, because killing this many birds in a day, you got to make sure your blood bin is emptied, make sure your viscera trough is clean, stay on top of it so it doesn't build up at the end. So once the last bird goes into the ice bath, you tie a butcher's twine around it, and you push it all the way in the bottom, and then that butcher twine is left out of the ice bath, your ice bucket bin, so you could fish it out later, because you need to get the temperature on your last bird to ensure that all birds are down to temp. Now, this is a terrible waiting game, and this is what makes days turn into from 10 hours to 16 hours, because once those birds are down to temp, you still have to package them. And this time frame is the one break that you may get all day working at this plant. The owner would usually come by with pizzas to ensure that the staff didn't leave during this lag time, because a lot of times these people would be like, all right, I'm going to go get food, and then just never come back. So the boss always made sure that there was large pizzas, cigarettes, and a case of energy drinks. People thought he was the best for this, but it wasn't. He didn't do it for them, he did it for himself. So once your bird's down to temp, half the crew cleans up, half the crew starts packaging. There's many ways to package chickens. You could vacuum seal them, you could wrap them. We bagged them. We had several trough tables with drains in them, and we'd use long hooks and fish them out of these blue slush bins and start sorting. Green birds over here, blue birds over there, double bands over here, et cetera, et cetera. And once the bin was empty, we would start packaging. Now, contamination. The person who holds the bag is not the person who puts the bird in the bag. You don't want to introduce salmonella to the outside of the bag. So one person, his whole job is to handle the raw chicken. Once it goes in the bag, it is clean. And the bag is passed over to a person who is running a vacuum gun, which is essentially like a hose that you stick in the bag and it just sucks all the air up. Then you twist the bag to tighten it. And then a wall-mounted stapler is right there to close it. And then you put it in a box. It's fair to say if you have 10 hours worth of slaughtering chickens, you're going to have about 5 hours worth of packaging chickens doing it this way. In this next segment, Ryan, someone I used to work alongside I did, I guess, like cutting at the facility she works at, which is the first USDA mobile slaughter and processing facility in America. She works and helps operate the cutting side of it. She's phenomenal when it comes to organizational skills and ensuring that all the co-op members are happy and the schedules are all met and all the, you know, making sure the lights turn on. And she's a great person. Her name's Carrie. And she's going to talk about the beginning of her career in the meat industry, which happens to be in the poultry side of it. So I hope you enjoy this piece with Ryan and Carrie.
I quit there in 89. That was the year I got married.
And how long did you work there before quitting?
6 years.
6 years. Maybe you could describe for someone who has no idea what this place is, roughly how many people it employs or how big small the facility is.
I have no idea how many people they employ.
In the hundreds or?
I would say. I would guess. So. Probably more than when I was there 30 years ago.
And what?
89, 99, 2009, 2019. It'll be 30 years next year.
Since you've been there?
Yeah.
So you were a young lady at that. You're still a young lady, but you were even younger.
Yes. I was right out of high school.
Right out of high school.
Mm-hmm. Needed full-time work. They had full-time positions. So I went there.
So this is a big employer in your area that
yes.
you grew up in. So there's a lot of jobs available there, and...
Yes, and you don't have to have a whole lot of education to get them.
Huh.
They're just physical jobs.
Yeah. And did it have anything to do with the fact that your dad was a meat cutter that you were aware of it, or not really? Completely
separate? That got me the job?
Yeah, or just that
it
made you want to go into it at all?
No, I didn't really want to go into it at all.
Huh.
I would have rather gone into meat wrapping at a store.
Okay.
But... this is the jobs that were available when I needed a job, so that's where I went.
Yeah. So probably much fewer meat wrapping jobs, but a ton of jobs at this place, at this poultry processing place.
Yes.
Were you anticipating staying there a long time, or you had no idea?
You know, when I started, I thought it was just going to be for a couple years, because I really wanted to get into a meat wrapping job. And I applied fairly regularly while I worked at Draper
okay.
for other jobs. Mm-hmm. I stayed there longer than I anticipated. You get into what's normal and routine, and it wasn't hard work. And it was physically hard work, but and worked a lot, so paid well.
And how was that structured? Was it some sort of shift work? Were there three shifts? Or?
I guess they run three shifts now, but when I was there, we only ran one shift.
Okay. With plenty of overtime, mandatory overtime?
Mandatory overtime, yes.
But that was okay with you?
They made that clear when they hired you, that overtime was mandatory.
And what did that normally look like? Like, 50 hours a week, 60 hours a week, or who knows?
It just depended on the year and the time, and if they had too many birds, somebody grew, that kind of thing. Huh. We had, if they had the birds that had to be processed, we had to work.
Yeah. And this is chicken and turkey?
Nope, just chickens.
Just chickens. What section of the plant did you work in? One particular area or all over?
I worked a lot all over, more than a lot of people did. But mostly I worked in the cut-up area. The evisceration part, I didn't do a whole lot of that. I was cutting breast. Up birds. Yeah.
Okay. And then, like, into boneless breasts and or whatever.
Yes. Legs there was a whole crew that just did boneless breasts.
Just the boneless breasts.
Yep.
And you did some of that crew, and you also just did general piecing out of the birds.
Yes, mostly I was on the cut-up line.
And they're coming into you how?
Hanging upside down from their ankles.
Okay.
With their little wings spread out.
And then you got knife in hand and you're...
Yep, you cut the wings off first, then you cut the breast, then you cut the back, then you cut the legs. And then you throw it all together.
Is this going on to a conveyor belt?
Yes. Or,
okay, and so then it hits conveyor belt. And then at some point, someone's packaging them, and they're getting shipped out to retail stores.
Right. One person cuts one wing, puts it in a tray. One wing, puts it in a tray. So it's getting put together as it's shifting down the belt. Like if it was a cut-up chicken, one wing, then another person does the other side. They put their wing in the package.
So as you're cutting, you're also packaging?
Wings. That's that. And backs. You cut and package.
Okay.
Otherwise, it comes to a table, and there'll be and you set the breast down beside it, and there'll be another person that'll put the breasts and legs on.
Yeah.
And they weren't cutting anything.
And there's a team of people doing the same exact thing as you in that area.
Yes.
Oh.
I did a lot of work in the, we called it the down below part, because we did all the packaging and pricing, and all the scales were all down there, too. So I did that a lot, also. I ran a scale there. It comes packaged,
okay.
And I put a label on it.
Labeling.
Yeah, well, weigh it, label it, put it in a box, and ship it on the conveyor belt so it can go down and get taped up and packed and put on a pallet. Yeah. I worked in the coolers, too. Because I was young and strong still, so I could do that too.
And what was that? Throwing boxes, freight?
Yeah.
Stacking pallets?
Yes.
And that, okay. So that's where everything gets to, into this big cooler.
Yes.
And gets shipped out of there.
Yes.
It's like the last stop or something.
Well, you pallet it all up, and then they would wrap it up the pallets and wherever they would go. I mean, it was always orders that you were working on throughout the day for a certain place. So that pallet would, you would be making stuff for that pallet for that order.
For the certain order, which would probably be some retail store somewhere that's going to.
Right.
Yeah. Do you have any idea how many birds came through there a day, or it's just like no clue?
I used to know, but I'm not sure now.
Yeah, and it's probably changed by now anyway.
It's a lot.
So do you have, this is a USDA inspected place, do you have inspectors looking over your shoulder as you're working, or were they more?
Yes, there were inspectors there constantly. On the evisceration line, there's inspectors every so often. They have places they have to be. And in our cut-up area, there was still two inspectors that walked around and made you roll your sleeves up, made sure you had earplugs in. Mostly that's what our inspectors did.
Really?
Serious. Yeah, because you couldn't have any clothes showing below your smocks, so they made you roll up sleeves, and it was mandatory that you wore earplugs, so they would do that too.
What about cut gloves? Yes, no?
Mandatory that you wear cut gloves too. They didn't even look for that because you didn't cut unless you had it.
What about wrist guards, no?
No, the cut glove came up to your wrist.
Okay.
They were pretty high up.
Yeah. Can you tell us about the strike? This was a union shop?
Yes. Right after I started, they went on strike, and I was excited because it was fun. People brought us pizzas and donuts, and we stood outside and had bonfires, and it was nice. But they weren't getting very good pay raises. I mean, I think they were only like at $7-$8 an hour, and all the other poultry processing places were getting a lot more, and they hadn't given those guys raises for a long time. So they went on strike. I had only been there a very short time, so I really didn't know the politics that were involved in that. Mm-hmm. But they brought in a bunch of illegal workers. I know a couple different times they all ran out the back door when enforcement came.
So this is while you were on strike, they brought in legal workers to try to fill your spots?
I'm sure they didn't purposely do it, but there were people that ran when the support enforcement showed up out the back doors. Like, all of a sudden, there'd be people blending in with our fire that we didn't know who they were. Mm. It was like, hi, who are you?
Yeah.
And they were, like, had been in there working, and they're, like, out there trying to blend in at night so that nobody's going to pick them up.
Okay. Yeah. So you guys were camping out there, or?
Nobody, like, spent the night, but there were people that stayed in shifts all day long and all night long. Mm-hmm. I don't think it was 24/7, but it was fairly late.
Did the company eventually meet the requests of the union workers?
There was a lot of negotiation, and the people accepted a contract, so.
Okay.
I don't know, 30 years ago, I don't really remember, you know, what. Healthcare was big then too. They wanted to keep. We had good healthcare through that union, and they wanted to keep that. And they were trying to, you know, make it cost a lot more and stuff like that. And they didn't want that. They got a decent contract. I felt like I had a decent contract when I signed it.
Mm. And then you. So after a few days, however long it was, then you got back to work.
Yeah, we were out for probably almost a month.
Almost a month of striking.
At least 2 weeks.
A couple of weeks. But then they renegotiated the contract. You were back
to
work.
Before we went out on strike, you know, I was down there with the scales. And so, I mean, you could have done all kinds of sabotage stuff to make it so, you know, it would be bad for them. And they had everybody that was a higher up person that wasn't with the union. They were there watching you 24/7 when you were there. It was bad. They didn't want you taking any little chips out of machines to make them so they wouldn't work, all kinds of stuff. They watched you like a hawk that last 2 weeks before the strike. There was a lot of people in there.
Because they knew there was tension at that point.
Yeah.
So they were wondering if someone was going to sabotage.
Right. They thought we were going to sabotage.
Yeah.
I mean, I was told outright, you know, don't be doing this, don't do this, don't do that, you know, that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm. And then after the strike and the renegotiation, things were kind of fine afterwards?
Yeah, everybody seemed fine. The management seemed to get along with everybody that came back, and there didn't seem to be any hard feelings or anything like that.
And then you stayed on for a few more years until you...
Probably five, because that was within my first 4 months, I think, I'd worked there, and then they went on strike.
Yeah.
So I'd only been there for a few months.
Mm-hmm. And so that was in the late 80s.
See, I graduated in 82. I went to work at her in 84. So it was 84, probably.
84. And this facility is still going strong, probably doing...
even more.
Yeah.
That was great. That just paints a great picture of what it's like in the bigger side of the poultry industry. Makes you think about, you know, what are you working for? What are you working hard for? Some people just need rent. Some people just need a job. Some people need health care. Some people need other benefits. More than the satisfaction of knowing a job well done. Because in some scenarios, many people don't have that. You know, if you love what you're doing, every day is a vacation, man. And I know that I love what I'm doing, but certainly not every day is a vacation. And the journey to satisfactory work was anything but. It was a fucking nightmare. You know, whatever success I have, I really owe to my wife for evaluating what I'm worth and reading every, you know, contract companies have offered me and things like that. I'm too self-deprecating to have done all that myself. And that reminds me of this one anecdote. I was looking for extra money and we heard about this mobile poultry consulting position where there's this mobile poultry unit here where I live in Washington, and they were having trouble with labor, and they operated one season and wanted to start off their next season off right. And this unit's idea was to go around and go to small farms, like a mobile slaughter unit, but it was for mobile chicken processing, an MPU, mobile processing unit, or PCMU, poultry, mobile, poultry, I don't know, had a bunch of names. And I ended up agreeing to this consulting deal where I did training with their staff. So I did a dry run training of just food safety, knife work, identifying parts of the chicken and things like that. And then they were going to be trained on the physical aspects of the unit. You know, how to put on the refrigeration, things, getting potable water supplies, affidavits, drainage. And my job was to solely focus on the technical aspect of slaughtering and harvesting poultry. I gave them 4 days, you know, initial training day, then 3 days on site to go over how to kill, how to shackle, how to dress your birds, how to, you know, do their jobs essentially, or do the jobs that I was training them for. So the initial first day was great. You know, these five people or whatever, they took it very well. They took meticulous notes, went over food safety, went over chilling times. Like this was an air chilled system, made them familiar with paperwork that I helped, you know, come up with for them to have this, you know, to make this whole process easier. This wasn't USDA. This was also USDA exempt. They were meeting the less than 1,000 birds a day to be under Washington inspection. Now, the person who built this unit and helped run this, the company, was like, all right, that was great. Thanks for doing that. Our first day of operation is a week from today, and we want you to be there for the first day of operation. So I'm there. I had to take a ferry to get there. I had to wake up at the ass crack of dawn. I was living at the base of Mount Baker at the time and had to go out to one of the San Juan Islands. It was not that sweet. Feeling confident in my training session and excited to get going with this staff that I made this great rapport with a week earlier, I was disappointed to see that not one of them were the people that I met previously. That in the intern time, those other people found better jobs or just didn't call back or probably said, fuck it, after the first initial meeting of me and realizing how much work there was going to be. Our goal was to kill so many birds that day. I think it was 200. And I get there and the farmer's like, oh, great. Are you Travis? And I was like, yeah. And he's like, so you're in charge? I'm like, no, I'm not in charge. I'm just a consultant. He's like, all right, well, I want my gizzards, my feet, my neck, and all this. And I'm confused, being like, what the fuck? So I asked them where they're receiving all their paperwork was. And they're like, oh, we just got here. Someone told us we had to level out the truck. And I was like, oh, so we're not ready to go. And I was under the impression that they were going to get there hour and a half before, get their drainage, get their portable water system, get all their paperwork, you know, inspect the birds, because this is what I went over with all these people who weren't there, with people who are now doing other construction jobs or labor jobs, and that I really missed at this moment. basic things like how to turn on the Thermal King. People didn't know that. I had experience with cooling units on, you know, driving refrigerated trucks. I was able to get it going after watching a YouTube video on the computer of the farmer, on the farmer's computer. And then an error code rang up, and I got on phone with the distributor, or not the distributor, but, you know, like tech support, essentially. Because I didn't have a manual, because that would have been too easy. All right, so this error code means this. So here's the sequence of events you got to do to clear this error code, blah, 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 blah. And it happened several times that day. And I was there for about 4 hours before the first bird got killed, because we had to go over that training, make sure the truck was level, make sure that it was on and running, that there's enough diesel, and all these things that, you know, fundamentally I went over about processing, that I had to essentially train people on the spot after doing this other stuff. And I'm not telling this story to be like, I overcame this great thing. It's just me more bitching than anything and talking about, well, I don't really enjoy consulting, or I don't enjoy consulting with the idea of expectations at the end of it. I like the idea of me saying, I could offer you this information that is in my head. You could write it down. You could videotape it. You could do whatever. But once I leave here, it is over. If your staff quits the day I leave, I hope someone remembers what I said or who's still there. So I'm figuring out what positions people should be good at. And there's some dude who's, you know, super eager to kill. And I'm like, all right, so you're not going to kill. And then some really shy, weird guy. And I was like, all right, you'll kill. And then just one other dude who ended up showing up 4 hours late. And I had eviscerate. I think it was literally just a 3-person crew. And I'm back there and we're slaughtering birds. And the back of the truck had a lift gate on it that you could put birds on, and then a plucker, and then they would go through a window. It was a variation of the setup that I talked about earlier in the show, but with less birds and less people and less space. So the person who was killing the birds or slitting the throats, every time he did it, he said, thank you for your life. That was weird to me, because it's just something that I never even thought about. And I was like, ugh. All right, anyway, I don't know. I just thought of that. So we get our 200 birds killed that day. It took all day. And then the person who, I guess, who was in charge, and I don't know how they picked who was in charge, because all these people were hired at once. Maybe they just said you. Was like, oh, they told me the farmer wants this many birds parted out and packed this way, because they were all in the ice air chill. And the air chill is, birds will dry out in there after a while, and they will also get too frozen after a while. It's a double-edged sword, because it works super quick, but it's also not, you have such a small window. Now, teaching people to part out birds and this situation was never put on the table. This facility was not built for it. It was not part of their program. But yet I had this farmer who's staring at me being like, well, aren't you going to do it? I called the people who hired me and explained the situation and explained what their guidelines were and how everything was built up and what they were legally allowed to do or legally allowed to do. And partying birds was not in the realm of inspection. They pretty much said, well, can you do it? Can you just do it? You know, we're going to talk to you about it earlier, but like, you know, come on, just do it. If you're cool, you would do it. So reluctantly, I did. The third day of consulting, because this is a 4-day gig, this was about a week later, and I was going to fine-tune the skills that they had or something. So two of the three people were still there. There was one new person there. So it wasn't as bad as it was. The plucker, there was issues with the timing mechanism to get it to stop at the certain time. And I remember that the scalder revolution wasn't set properly. So they're getting all overscalded because they wanted to speed up the process in between the time I last met them and messed with their gauges, which is awesome. So it's just other things about equipment that luckily I had terrible cell phone service and was able to kind of watch a video on equipment that was made in a different language. Got it working again. Essentially the same situation. I understood why they had problems their first year. It wasn't the design of it, which there were big flaws. I would have done ice chilled and made rooms for bins. It was their staff. Minimum wage people, or people who make minimum wage. I think minimum wage a lot of times is viewed as people want to strive for something more than minimum wage. It's human nature to always want to grab for the higher rung, to have your quote unquote upward mobility. And when you have a job that has four minimum wage positions and needs to be ran fluidly, and when someone, you know, could do a minimum wage job where they don't have to get up at 5 a.m. and take a ferry, or they don't have to have all these responsibilities when they could just do literally anything else. But that's what their staffing budget was. That's what they decided on with all their pricing. So just food for thought on that. My last day of consulting, I was running late because I had to kill a beef in the morning and then run out there. And they knew this. And I got there and I was told by someone I've never met before, "Where have you been?" In a tone of anger. And I looked back and said, "Excuse me?" And he was, I guess now, the manager, the new boss of this motley crew. And he was now, he was making more than all of them. So he was in charge. And he had experience working at the facility that Carrie was talking about in the last segment. He used to work over there. And he was running the crew of people that I'd never trained before, that have never worked in this industry either, because they were brand new people making minimum wage. I say, "Excuse me?" And he said, "Well, where have you been? We've been waiting for you. You know, you're supposed to be this expert and et cetera." And I said, "I didn't think you guys would be waiting for me. I let so-and-so know in the office who was part of this program that this was my schedule. And I had more of a overseeing component to tighten up loose ends." 30 seconds into this interaction, I almost got a case of the fuckets, where I wanted to be like, "This is very unpleasant for me. Your tone, me being berated, you swinging it around because you're in charge of these three people. You have to put me down for some reason." But I didn't. I just stood there, bit my tongue, thought my teeth were going to touch, and said, "Let's get started." I gave it my all. I taught them the best I could. And at the end of the day, the person who was eviscerating got a call from a relative about a construction job opportunity, and he told the person in charge, the manager, that this would be his last day. But my consulting was over. A few weeks later, I was called by this company for more consulting days. They'd give me more money and pay me at the current rate. And if I was interested, a full-time position as the lead of the operation. I politely declined, and I reevaluated what my role in consulting for any company would be in the future. You give a man a fish, he eats for a day. You teach a man to fish, he eats for life. I'm more on the aspect of, I will tell a man how to fish, and he better be able to figure it out through notes and videos. All right, that's going to do it for this week's episode of the Meat Block Podcast. Big thanks to Carrie and Ryan for that awesome interview. And if you want to get a hold of us at the Meat Block Podcast, you want to get a hold of Ryan, he is at Gather and Break on Instagram. David is at A Farm Butcher on Instagram. I am at American Butcher on Instagram. And Facebook, we also have a Facebook group, The Meat Block. You want to get a hold of The Meat Block itself, we are at The Meat Block Pod on Twitter, at The Meat Block on Instagram, or you can email us at themeatblockpodcast@gmail.com. And if you want to help out The Meat Block, the best way to do that is by going to the Apple review and leaving us a 5-star. And please, please leave a comment. It means the world to us. And until next time, keep your knife sharp and live in the margin.
I got on my cowboy boots, jeans, and a lawyer shirt, mirrored sunglasses, a mobile phone. I guess I look like some Porter Ansys dope dealers out on bail just trying to get home. But I ain't in jail, and I got me a guitar. Got a little band that's hotter than a rocket. Sometimes we're sloppy, we're always loud. Tonight we're just owner and locked in the pocket. I said, screw you, we're from Texas. Screw you, we're from Texas. Screw you, we're from Texas. We're from Texas, baby. I said, screw you. In the other states, they're okay. Texas is the place I want to be, and I don't care if I ever go to Delaware anyway. Cause we got Stubbs and Greenhall and Antone's and John T's Country Store. We got Willie and Jack and Jack, Robert Earl, Pat, Corey, Charlie, man, so many more. So screw you, we're from Texas. Screw you, we're from Texas. Screw you, we're from Texas. We're from Texas. Screw you, sing it with me. Screw you, we're from Texas. Screw you, we're from Texas. Screw you, we're from Texas. We're from Texas. Screw you. A bad reputation because of what happened in Dallas and Waco. And our corporations, they are corrupt, and our politicians are swindlers and loco. But when it comes to music, my friend, I believe these words are as true as St. John the Revelator's. Our Mr. Vaughn was the best that there ever was, and no band was cooler than a 13th floor elevator. So screw you. We're from Texas. Screw you. We're from Texas. Screw you. We're from Texas. We're from Texas. Screw you. Screw you. We're from Texas. Screw you. We're from Texas. Screw you. We're from Texas. We're from Texas. Screw you. Screw you. We're from Texas. Screw you. We're from Texas. Screw you. We're from Texas. We're from Texas. Screw you. We're from Texas. Screw you.
Now, if you haven't figured out that I do stuff at the end after the song now, I kind of changed the format a few months back or a month back, or I don't know. But that song was Ray Willie Hubbard, Screw You, We're From Texas. And that goes out to my teammate, Brian Butler. By teammate, what do I mean? I mean the WBC, the World Butchers Challenge. I am a member of Butchers of America team. I am part of an amazing group of individuals that you are going to get to know very well in this podcast. The event is 2 years away, and it's going to be in Sacramento in 2020. And it is going to be awesome and exciting and so much fun. So stay tuned for more on that. And if you want to support Butchers of America team, you could do that by finding our Facebook page, clicking on the GoFundMe, and then donating some money. That page is also linked on my Instagram account, and I post it regularly on Facebook as well. If you work at a company in marketing and you sell a product and or service and you want to sponsor the Butchers of America, there is also that option. You know, we need uniforms, we need PPE, we need all these things to make this happen, as well as practices and training. If you sponsor us, you know, I would probably talk about it in this platform. All right. Until next time, keep your knives sharp and live in the margin.